Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera, Blind. I'm the RPG Chick. We are here in the Sanctuary of Miel Avest, which, you know, where are the defenses and such? From what I understand, these are all, or some of them at least, are former, well, cast-offs of the Changing God, such as we are. So since we're standing right here next to this Chalcedon, let's talk to him first. This man is less flesh than muscle, running in corded bands from his thick neck down his broad chest, wide arms, and calloused hands. He focuses on you, his cold eyes flicking from your face and the shape of your tattoo to the width of your shoulders, like a prospective buyer sizing up a particularly dangerous animal. And he thinks, here she is, the one I've heard about. But is she a resource or a threat? Excuse me. Then he smiles, and it is as wide and genuine as any you've ever seen. The most advanced of our sire's children, here at last. I'm surprised you didn't make your way here sooner. He thinks, a resource, of course, and a fine one at that. At least until she proves otherwise. So he's already made up his mind, and we haven't said anything that we're a resource. Who are you? I am the Chalcedon, commander of the Changing God's forces in the Endless Battle, the guardian of his grand design, and his champion. He raises a self-deprecating hand. Not that our sire truly needs my help, of course, but some here, in the very land he created for us, would rather acknowledge all he's done for us. He shakes his head slowly. Some of these disagreements can be resolved through debate, but not all, of course. Not all. I always like to do that. Commander of the Changing God's armies in the Endless Battle. What is this Endless Battle all about? Ingratitude, he says with a deep, calming breath. Our sire gave us long lives and powerful gifts, a home to protect us from the sorrow. The first cast-off wasn't content. She spread lies about our sire and turned some of his children against him. He presses his lips together. Sorry, just checking my... I wanted to make sure I was recording. Hard to see green over green here. She's dead now, but the damage is long done. Our family is divided. The First's army would see us destroy the Changing God and seek freedom from his plans for us. He growls under his breath. They are stubborn children, refusing the medicine that will save their lives because the taste isn't sweet enough to their liking. What's the point of the Endless Battle?
I'll remember that.
The point? The point is that our sire was defending himself against the First attacks. She thought she was entitled to his knowledge, and she thought she'd wrest it from him by force. And now? He looks haunted for a moment, and his voice lowers. Now I'm not sure we could stop if we wanted to. Tiber exhales, rubbing his eyes. When he notices you looking his way, he waves his hand. Nothing. It's nothing. Carry on. So, the Endless Battle is self-defense. We fight to preserve our sire's plan for us, while the others seek to destroy it. And him. Have you seen the Changing God lately? No, but that's not unusual. His strategies absorb most of his time, which is why he leaves most of the work in the Endless Battle and the diplomacy in Miel Avest to me. He flashes a grin, and as you might imagine, he measures time differently than us. It's been a number of years since I've seen him. I doubt our sire has noticed. He thinks, has he forgotten us? Has he forgotten me? Tell me about the Changing God's grand design. As you know, he moves from body to body. He does this to test the capabilities of those bodies to their fullest to ensure their strength. And when he has done so, he gives them to us, gives us life, so that we might continue using them in service of his plans. He is like a sculptor, honing his art. He raises a finger. So you see, he's not flitting from body to body like some manner of vapid insect. Each cast-off is an improvement over the last. He lays a hand on your shoulder. Oh, so that makes me the best. And that means, of course, that you are the best of us, and the most suited to help us end this conflict. The sorrow will find us. Before that happens, we must end our conflict with each other. We must prepare our defenses. We must find some way to stop it. He has spent centuries creating stronger and stronger bodies before gifting them with awareness of their own. We are his weapons in his greater war against the sorrow. You're not upset that I opened the portal? Well, he says, chuckling, there is a touch of unease in it, you notice. I argued for the portal's closure to begin with, so I'm concerned that it's open again. But I trust that our sire knew what he was doing when he made you, so I have no doubt that the weakening of our defenses is a smaller part of his greater strategy. And he thinks, and should something happen, well, I will be safe for certain. You will? I'm looking for a cast-off named Mazoff who can repair the resonance chamber in Sega's cliffs. I'm assured that will stop the sorrow. Oddly enough, guys, I don't even remember this, but that's not unusual for me. Of course, he says, his eyes agleam. Our sire told me of the plans to build it. I should have known. He lays bracing hands on your shoulders. Speak to Adiris, if you haven't already. She will know where to find this Mazoff. Farewell. Farewell, little sister. Sister. King Diamond. let's see. Come now. I know for a fact some of you could use my ciphers. Okay, we got someone selling ciphers over there. He's just random cast-off named Cast-off. Oh, the stories I could tell about the first. Ask me about them when Adiris is through with you. Okay. My deals leave with me, brothers and sisters. Take advantage of them while I'm still here. Okay, you're selling stuff, Lady Anshe. Look at this, the woman declares. Our wayward sister, in the flesh. She spreads slender hands. Delicate spider webs of metal thread run through her fingers, studded with circular nodes that look too purposeful to be mere jewelry. The name's Anshe. Lady Anshe. But don't let that scare you off. I sell rare Numenera and a place to rest at a fair price. I can also upgrade certain clothing and equipment, but that's a bit more expensive. She gives you an assessing eye. She thinks this one will have spending money, I hope. A little bit. Take a look at what I've got, she adds more quietly. My prices are high, but you look like someone who values your friends, and my work will keep them safe. She claps her ornamented hands together with a clink. So, what do you need? Oh my. First some small talk. Wondering how much she charges for a rest. Let me just see this first. Alright, it'll cost you 110 shins. Holy crap. You'll get the best rest of your life here, I promise. The sorrow can't track you when you bed down here. Wise move. I don't sleep if I can help it either. Too much to do, you know? So 110. Where was the place where we could sleep? I have trouble remembering crap. There was a place where we could sleep for free, I think. We slept there once. Oh, with the entrance to the, what do you call it? Before the entrance to the gate. The endless gate. It's a free resting place. I don't know why. Can you remind me? I never asked her about a feritory. Oh, this? Oh, right. She was the one who spoke when we were about to activate it. Yeah. What did the feritory do to me? It killed you, of course. It'll do that every time. By the way, just ask Melmoth if they're there. Over there. The corner of her lip turns. Can you remind me what you said about the feritory? Rumor is that it's a last-ditch defense against the sorrow. But that's just a rumor. Can't tell you if it's truth or wishful thinking. Do you get a lot of business here in Miel Avest? Well, put it like that, no, she says, grinning. And it's not normally me doing the selling, not like I used to. In normal times, I'm treating major customers to fancy dinners, yelling at my advisors, and sneaking in the odd bespoke order before more paperwork lands on my desk. She shrugs. But these aren't normal times. People are saying the sorrow's on the hunt again. I don't know if it's true, but better safe than sorry. So instead of passing the time arguing like everyone else around here, I'm back to being a humble merchant. She winks, for now. And she thinks my little empire can run itself for a while. I'll be back soon. Do you know anything else about the Faratory? Ugly thing has caught your fancy, huh? But no, can't help you. You must do quite a lot of business with the endless battle ongoing.
Making a note.
I don't know, she says carefully. I don't take sides or opinions on that conflict. Bad for business, sides. Your name is Lady Anshe? Are you royalty? Heh, only in a technical sense. A few years back, I did a favor for the type of person who can spin titles out of thin air. I told her I only wanted the money, but she insisted. She shrugs. So, Lady Anshe, it's opened a few stubborn doors over the years, but other than that, I don't wave it around much. What are those wires all over your hands? Inventions of mine, cobbled together from parts, of course, like everything. These beauties are wired, well, not really, but, you know, into my head. I use them to build and fix things that are really, really small. She beams at her hands. I've had them almost as long as I've been alive. They're tools. Shrugging. I use them in my custom work. You don't seem upset that I opened the portal into Miel Avest. That's because closing it wasn't necessary to begin with. The shields are good enough. She rolls her eyes. Our brothers and sisters worry too much. Must run in the family. One of my companions is troubled by demons of some kind. Can anyone here help him? She looks immediately at Eritus, who brightens, literally and figuratively, at being noticed. Can't say I've ever seen something like this before, she murmurs, and none of us are doctors, sorry to say. I wonder if anyone back in town, the chirurgeon, maybe? It's the closest we have to a doctor. Let's talk about those upgrades you mentioned. Sure thing. But in case I wasn't clear before, I can't do much with what you're wearing. It's pretty much good as is. She scratches her chin. Your friends, on the other hand, I can help. Who needs work done? Tybeer? Me? Why me? Tybeer says, then sniffs himself. Oh, you do laundry too? Not even a little, she says, studying your companion with a critical eye. His sark and mantle are a bit clumsy. I could finesse the rough edges. Minor work. Will cost you 130 shins. I'll be more comfortable when I get more money. Not like a fifth of my money here. For someone else. Eritus? I don't need upgrades, Eritus declares, outraged. He immediately falters. Do I? You might, she says, frowning as she examines your companion. Let me take a look at your doublet and undershirt. I could do something with... slits? Possibly slits. Maybe vents. She folds her arms. 75 shins and wear square. So 75 for him. Calistige. My equipment is perfect the way it is, she says, arching an eyebrow. Oh, of course it is, Anshe says, straightening, but there's perfection and tailored perfection. She sweeps a practiced eye over Calistese's gown. I can think of a number of small, understated touches I could make to your gown, love. Wouldn't cost more than 65 shins. That's cheap. Let's touch up Calistese's gown. Why not? Of course, she says, lifting her hand, fingers dancing. Ribbons of lights slip between them. She extends her arms with a long, suffering sigh, but favors you with a smile. I usually do my own work, dear, she says, drawing in a breath as the seam tightens. This is a welcome treat. Okay, this colorful, elegant dress belongs to Chalcedon. Endless copies of the same dress belong to her sisters. Lady Anshe modified the dress to offer superior protection, at least in this reality. Okay, so we got 3 armor, 5 resistance. Which I'm not sure what the old stats were. After a few minutes, she lets her hands fall. Finish, she says. Anyone else? You too, sister. I'll just take a look. Yeah, she does look different. Dimensional mantle. Somehow, Anshe's modifications to Calistee's dress appear to have impacted these shimmers, and they seem thicker. Somehow. Okay, so let's take a look before and after. He has 3 armor, 2 resistance. 5% evasion and 10% willpower. Good, she says, lacing her wire-strung fingers together. Hold still, please. Do I have to? He says, but he offers you a smile as the threads of his clothes begin moving of their own accord. Thank you, my friend. 7 armor. Wow. The only difference is here there's no resistance at all. Lady Anshe adjusted Aretas' shirt to offer limited protection to blasts of raw energy. About his cloak. This is unchanged. Okay. What? It still says... What? It didn't change here. It's supposed to be 7 armor. And this little thing is missing. I mean, one of 2 things are possible. It didn't take, somehow. And we don't have the upgrades. Or it's just showing us the old stats, but the stats actually are 7 armor. So, yeah, I don't know. So with that, I really don't want to spend 130 shins for nothing. Plus I'm not completely sure that he's actually going to stay with us. If we solve his quest, isn't he just going to turn back to like a farmer? A farmer type guy? Sure, she says, look all you want. All right, let's see what we have. We have a mystic marble. Ooh. It's expensive though. Summons a wisp that attacks a nearby enemy on its own, dealing 20 energy damage and 8 physical damage. Pretty cool, we haven't seen a wisp in this game yet. This dark glass sphere shows flashing, swirling colors beneath the surface that respond to your touch. As you watch the colors shift and swirl, you can sense the barely constrained power held by the glass container. Our mystical lore tells us that the origin of the mystic marble is unknown, but owners of the artifact have reported dreaming of a pearl at the heart of a shell the size of continents, far beneath a smooth ivory sea. Really? We can't use it without buying it. Impressively labeled canister. Converts all damage dealt to energy and plus 50% movement speed, 15% evasion, and plus 5 damage. Active entire crisis. Even though this round tin is a relic of some forgotten past, the label is bright and pristine. Archaic script swims across it, shimmering and melting into the truth. Huh. It has directions. Huh. Feeling limp in your lockets, Chammy? Weak in the tethers? When you're too tired to scrap, reach for this freshly sealed container of dill. Dill? Dill endues patented pounding. Direction. Open up a can. Repeat as needed. Possible side effects may encourage you to break faces and save the day. Can result in severe injury or death. Please do not use with the slightest bit of caution, as that would completely ruin the point of the product. If you're still breaking faces after 4 hours, consider yourself lucky. This is something Eretus would be really into, wouldn't he? So all the damage we deal, I'm guessing, turns into energy. We have Blood of the Elements. Permanent plus one resistance. A shifting substance fills this ordinary glass vial, existing in many states at the same time. Sometimes it is a blue liquid or a lump of solid black, before subtly becoming purple electrified plasma or pure white gas. Every phase is so quick, so short, it is impossible to be sure if the change is real, if the substance exists in every state at once, or if it even exists at all. There is a small inscription around the edges of the vial's cork, the letters fading in and out of view as if engraved using a similar substance. It probably, possibly, maybe spells out Blood of the Elements. I think it does. One can only wonder what would happen if someone were to consume a substance such as this. Well, I exactly know what would happen. We'd get plus one resistance. Now, I wonder if we can use this multiple times. Like, buy one, put it to last cast off, plus one resistance, buy another one, put it, now we have plus two resistance, you know, could we use two? Neat. A chuckling shroud? Only usable by the last cast-off. 3 resistance, plus 20% willpower, and plus 5% on intellect tasks. Sweet. A cloak made... This has a little more money than we even have. A cloak made of fine tendrils that rub together, producing a sound like human chuckling. The sound is a carrier for a stream of mental energy that swirls around the wearer, shielding them from different types of attacks on the mind. My mystical lore tells me that you recall a fragment of a story that could be about this object. The magician's laughter could be heard through the halls of his great tower as he pulled each strand of viscera from their lifeless bodies, binding them together to create a great union of laughter through death. His creation would haunt all who wore it with the laughter of his dead victims. My god. Okay, we got our usual spray flesh. We got a Varith here. You recognize this ring fragment. It is called Varith, or Wisdom Chained, and it is one half of the artifact known as the Shadow Ring. It's the other half of this thing. I'm gonna come back here and buy this. I don't want to spend $250 on this. It's more than half our money. You recall that this artifact belonged to a cast-off, though their identity escapes you. You remember only that the Changing God himself sundered this ring at the height of a cold rage and infused each half with mutually repellent energies. They have been separated from each other ever since. The Changing God went through immense trouble to separate these two rings. It must be possible to reunite them. I gotta remember to come back here. Ooh. Runic Blade of Tol Danor. I know, if I sell some of this crap, these oddities I have, I could buy some of this stuff, right? So 10 damage physical and 10 damage from energy. Plus 2 damage per effort applied, max plus 8. The jagged rune-like script etched into the gray black blade is a dark, deep red hue. Any eyes that linger too long on the strange letters are rewarded at first with discomfort and then with ever-increasing pain, rather than any measure of understanding. Upon touching the weapon for the first time, it grants an image of a long-lost, wondrous place, imbuing a sense of smoldering betrayal and tremendous loss. The immense power of the blade is self-evident, but the havoc and pain it brings to foes seem to stay with it, and its bearer, as a lingering cloud of guilty remembrance. Thanks to our mystical lore, we know that no one truly knows the origin or purpose of this device apart from its name. Some whisper half-remembered tales about it being one of three powerful armaments created by an infamous betrayer, belonging to a forgotten race in an age-long past. Others further claim that its creation was part of a desperate and futile attempt to save his kind from a long and slow annihilation. Well, seems like a powerful blade indeed. Outworn Buckler. Plus 15% evasion. When hit by an attack, confers protection for the weary to all allies in medium range. So you get plus 15% willpower and evasion. Active for one round. This simple wooden buckler, painted green, would not be out of place in a pile of surplus training shields. Two large black iron straps form an X shape across it. It looks like it has taken more than its share of weapon blows, and it may have been in use for far too long. Hopefully it can't be destroyed, right? Slight increase, plus 5% in evasion for that thing. But what's really useful is this here, protection for the weary. So anyone at least kind of near to him. So wait, I have living Exuvia? No, I have Exuvia, and this is living Exuvia. Sheesh. So now it's coming up, these comparisons. So, two more of armor. Resistance goes down. But we, minus 3 to might and speed, minus 15%. I don't want that. But plus 1 to intellect pool. You know, I might have actually seen this one and I just went with regular Exuvia because I don't... Yeah, I need this stuff. Maybe not might so much, but speed, yeah, will be helpful. Plus 3 mental damage on esoteric attacks or cipher attacks. The biological armor is form-fitting and easy to wear, yet offers superior protection. Upon closer inspection, you find a synth-steel device shaped much like a human spine fitted into the back of the Exuvia, which binds to the wearer's nervous system. It provides additional mental fortitude, but it also makes the armor stiffer and harder to wear. Our natural lore says that the spine has an additional function to keep the Exuvia alive. It constantly stimulates the biological material of the armor, ensuring that it retains the strength it had in life. I'm going to pass on that, at least for now. In fact, I have to pass on it. I don't have that much money. Unless I sell stuff. Oddities. Sting Charge, we've seen. Slug Splitter, we've seen. And stuff like Rush, yes. It's all stuffy. Hyper-Illutrated Force. Don't think we've seen this. This crystal pulses and shimmers with barely contained energies, rapidly expanding and contracting. A needle protrudes from the crystal center. If inserted into a vein, the crystal's amplified energies can be absorbed to increase the user's physical stamina and muscle mass by a great extent. These crystals are purified from a murky liquid found rarely in the Garavia Sound. When this purification process is done by a particularly skilled hand and repeated several times, crystals of even greater power are born. Refined Fleetfoot Moss. I'm not going to read this because it's going to be largely the same as the other Fleetfoot Moss, but yeah, it's six points of speed. Oh, it conceives movement. That's why we can use these things and attack at the same time if someone's near us. Pretty neat. This we've seen. We need more of that. It's expensive. Concentrated Splay Fresh, which is 16 points of health. Great Axe. Child's Grace. Plus one training level in persuasion skill, but negative one in deception and intimidation. We're bad enough with deception and intimidation. A maggot ringed with gold and silver scales lies within this glass vial. Placing the creature underneath one's tongue fills a user with a sense of calm and a somewhat naive purpose. I'm gonna come back here, guys. Here's the stuff we have. Okay, so that was literally, we just spoke with the Chalcedon and Lady Anshe. Stay tuned when we talk to more people. Before we leave here, I might sell a couple oddities and buy some stuff from her. You know me, siblings. I have the best goods in Greater Garavia. So thanks for watching, guys. Tune back next time when we talk to more people. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.